Excuse me, brothers and sisters, please. If someone could just turn off.
King looked out on his people and saw they were in great need. So he did what all great leaders do. He told them the truth.
Will you ignorant niggas please shut the hell up?
He just said what I think he said.
Is this it? This is what I got all those ass whoopings for? I had a dream once. It was a dream that little black boys and little black girls would drink from the river of prosperity, freed from the thirst of oppression. But lo and behold, some four decades later, what have I found but a bunch of trifling, shiftless, good-for-nothing niggas. And I know some of you don't want to hear me say that word. It's the ugliest word in the English language. But that's what I see now. Niggas. And you don't want to be a nigger. Because niggas are living contradictions. Niggas are full of unfulfilled ambitions. Niggas wax and wane. Niggas love to complain. Niggas love to hear themselves talk but hate to explain. Niggas love being another man's judge and jury. Niggas procrastinate until it's time to worry. Niggas love to be late. Niggas hate to hurry. Black entertainment television is the worst thing I've ever seen in my life. The revolution will be live.
Martin King's America and ours. Even the mere mention of the name, Martin Luther King, compels us to almost genuflect before the power of his memory in American life. It is a measure of the man that many people that call themselves conservatives today quote his words and even claim some part of his treasury of oratory to support their political positions. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., although lauded and lionized today for his role in the U.S. Civil Rights Movement, was especially in the last years of his life a virtual enemy of the state, spied on by the White House, betrayed by his friends and colleagues, and threatened by the FBI. An FBI Deputy Director, William Sullivan, in January 1964, called Reverend King, quote, the most dangerous Negro leader in America, unquote. That King is largely hidden from us today, for all we see, for the most part, are glimpses from his historic I Have a Dream speech of 1963. In 1967, a year before he was assassinated, Reverend King gave a remarkable speech in New York's Riverside Church that was titled Beyond Vietnam. But this was far more than an anti-war speech. It was an anti-imperial speech. Indeed, it was an anti-capitalist speech. Among Reverend King's words were these: true compassion is more than flinging a coin to a beggar. It comes to see that an edifice which produces beggars needs restructuring. A true revolution of values will soon look uneasily on the glaring contrast of poverty and wealth. With righteous indignation, it will look across the seas and see individual capitalists of the West investing huge sums of money in Asia, Africa, and South America, only to take the profits out with no concern for the social betterment of the countries and say, this is not just. It will look at our alliance with the landed gentry of South America and say, this is not just. The Western arrogance of feeling that it has everything to teach the others and nothing to learn from them is not just. A true revolution of values will lay hand on the world order and say of war, this way of settling differences is not just. This business of burning human beings with napalm, of filling our nation's homes with orphans and widows, of injecting poisonous drugs of hate into the veins of peoples normally humane, of sending men home from dark and bloody battlefields, physically handicapped and psychologically deranged, cannot be reconciled with wisdom, justice, and love. A nation that continues year after year to spend more money on military defense than on programs of social uplift is approaching spiritual death. Speeches such as these do not make the memorials broadcast by much of the major media on King's birthday. That's because those words, spoken over 30 years ago, continue to cut close to the way the American Empire does business today. The differences between the world he envisioned and the world that exists today can be measured in miles, not millimeters. That's because Reverend Dr. King was approaching a socialist vision of America and the world. For what else could have made him, in the words of the FBI, the most dangerous Negro leader in America? Reverend Dr. King was considered dangerous because he opposed the unmitigated greed and acquisition of wealth that is at the very heart of capitalism. If he were alive today and 76 years old, I've little doubt that he'd still be opposing this imperial war in Iraq and the relentless war on the poor that we see all across the nation. Politicians have used and misused the words and image of Reverend King, but it would be interesting to see if he would have used them if he were here. Would he have taken government money under the so-called faith-based initiative? And even if he took it, would he steal his tongue from speaking out against injustice? Would the country still be so bitterly split between rich and poor? Would the black middle class be so separated from the black poor? Would America's foreign policy still be one of unalloyed aggression against Latin America? Would Africa be virtually ignored? Would our national culture be so poisonous and materialistic? We don't really know the answers to these questions, but to think of these things gives us insight into the impact of his thinking and his passion. Much more than one black family lost something significant in April 1968. From Death Row, this is Mumia Abu-Jamal.
These commentaries are produced by Noel Hanrahan for Prison Radio.